Is there some Kleenex back there? Anybody know?
Get it.
Xerox the solid development fixes the drawing, right?
That's right. Xerox ink will not smear with turpentine. Prisma, if you spray fix it, some colors will bleed radically. This one, Copenhagen blue, I don't think it does. Ultramarine blue, for instance, does. Some of the violets do. So, you know, either avoid it, therefore, or anticipate it and use the bleed as a device. There are ways of even doing that. This color will transition pretty well from an orange into a blue. I think what I'll do, and I haven't thought about this at all yet, but as I look at it, I think what I'm going to have is I'm going to have this dark moonlight influence carry down through the first heads. And as we come down here, I'll pick up some more natural lighting filling up in here so that I can do these two heads in more natural flesh tones. And I'll give you an example of an eccentric flesh tone and then a common flesh tone down here, so you get sort of a little bit of both. Moonlight stuff works real well with violets, blacks, blues.
Yeah, he was the advisor to the Buffy transition.
No, they didn't want him in. They didn't tell me that, though. See, he messed it up. It wasn't one of their considerations. That's funny. They seem to be discriminating against him because in this other movie, A Time for a Kill that I've been working on. Did you find that one at all, Mia, over at the Frankfurt Balkan? Time for a Kill, or Time to Kill, A Time to Kill. Remember that movie? You didn't work on that one, did you? You worked on Mirror, right? Well, in this other one, he's in there, and he's also got a part in there, and they said, hey, make sure you don't put Donald Sutherland in there. Pattern or something. Obviously, the studio is saying the same about me. Okay, let's see. notice I went kind of a lavender and then it's kind of a rose madder, or what is they call this? Something that it's called. Mahogany red, of course.
Mahogany red's the color between the two heads there.
Yeah. Uh-huh. So we go from this Copenhagen blue, just kind of a sea blue, to this, what do they call it, bright violet, which would bleed if you sprayed it, and then into the mahogany red, and now into light umber in here.
It'll bleed if you spray it with spray fixtures?
The bright violet would. These umbers and earth tones won't bleed.
Yeah.
You can get a lot of mileage with some yellow ochre, which we've got for your foreheads. It seems to work quite nicely. And then in through the area around the cheeks, the ears, and the eyes, you'll want to put some a little bit of rouge there, even on men. And then down toward the bottom of the head, it's going to gray just a little bit for you. So, a little blue. And then over that, let's neutralize that blue with some dark brown. Prismacolor dark brown, burnt umber, and sepia. At a glance, they kind of all look the same. These heads are influenced by the moonlight, so this is about as strong of a red as we're going to get, going back to that mahogany red, which does have some red content. I don't know if you can see it too well, but let's see what it looks like there. If you want to just don't even bother with this thing.
So you're just hitting multiple color, you're not concerned about rendering at this point at all?
Nope.
It's more fun this way.
If all goes well, yeah. Try not to put colors next to each other that if they were to blend together would create gray, unless there's a place where I specifically wanted that. So if I want orange juxtaposed with blue, if I smear them together, they're going to go gray. They're complements. But if I put violet between the orange and the blue, they'll transition, because the violet relates to both. Now I just have to figure out what exactly I want for color content at the bottom of this composition. And I'll go to this, what they call bronze. Probably a hideous color scheme by the time we're done, but it won't matter because you'll see the technique in several different ways, some more naturalistic than others. Let's leave it at that and start smearing. Time flies. This little canister is the best thing I've found for terpenoid, although Chef says he found one that's the same general thing but flat, so you can carry it in case of it.
So I'll bring it next week.
As a rule, you want to start off with your lighter colors and your warmer colors. working to your cool. And just like Norman Lindsay's pencil pen drawings, I don't really feel that I have to be airbrushed smooth. I can get it that way if I want. So in places I may, in other places I might not. Now, once I got some black on it, I want to be real careful with it. So I'll flip over to the other side of the Kleenex.
But you didn't change the surface on the Kleenex as you were working.
No. Right.
Do you intend to pick out with this, or do you?
Yes, I intend to pick out. And to draw back in, too. It'll be both subtractive and additive. Look at that horribly ugly blue. It's just what I want.
Is that blue,
spray fix.
Right. Is that color one of them?
This Copenhagen blue, I don't believe it is. I think it's one of the blues that's safe in that regard. Ultramarine is not a color that you can spray fix without bleeding.
So I guess you should test your color before.
Yeah.
But this is a very specific palette that you go after with the Prismacolor.
What do you mean?
This blue I'm taking in is one you've used and so forth.
Yeah, actually, if I had ultramarine and I felt that it was the appropriate color, I'd use it because I don't intend to spray fix this anyway.
I see.
Don't forget, you can still work on the back of it. Sound disquietingly peaceful in the other room. I shudder to think of what masterpieces Gregory and Robert are churning out.
You're not taking into account that those two characters are blind, are you?
Which two? These two?
Yeah, Buffy and Buffy.
Yeah, they got dark here as far as I'm concerned.
Okay.
You could like tilt a little bit so we don't get the back of your head.
Maybe you can bring this camera this way a little and shoot it this way. Maybe that makes it worse.
You want to move the camera?
I mean, no.
It'd be easier if you just get back.
Okay, maybe you can zoom back. How's that?
That's better.
Now, Pee-wee does have black hair, in any case. It doesn't mean that we want to leave it flat black. I'm going to put some color into these hair masses also. Let's pick up a little ochre, maybe.
On these color tops, Mark, do they color scan them, or would they strip the type just directly over the top of these for presentation?
Which color comps?
The color comp.
Like I'm doing here?
Yeah.
Or would they do what?
How would their presentation?
They'd either color Xerox them and present them as is, or they would scan them into the computer and adjust them or leave them as is and put type on them that way. It's remarkable how little you'll have to do to make this head work. Anyone who was here during Alan Hunter's demonstration of the Johnny Depp movie, what was the name of that movie?
Think of Time.
All these movies sound the same. You remember how quickly he was able to get that head. Okay, we're pretty much at the same point with this. And we have a moonlight color scheme, which is what he demonstrated on that day as well. Yellowish moon here, it's going to go green, so I'm avoiding that. Obviously, yellow and blue make green. Unless they specify, I usually try to give them some indication of what medium I'm going to use. You know, I don't want them to come along and at the end say, there's one thing I hate and I've always hated, and that's Prismacolor. So I just make sure that there's no real surprise. That's a real good question.
Seems like you really have to educate, because this doesn't look like Prismacolor.
Is he okay?
Yeah.
Yeah, they won't know.
I was thinking you were going to do it in Prismacolor.
No, yeah, that's true.
Quite different.
Very good point. I have had occasion where I say I'm going to do this and paint it in Prismacolor. And they look at me like I'm talking another language.
Yeah.
Well, that's why it's a good idea to have a couple examples with you. You know? Even with art directors you've worked with before, if you're using a medium that you haven't used with them before, maybe it's a good idea then to
have
some samples. Right. Remember, too, that as a rule, bright colors don't count for much if there aren't dull colors in the same piece. Unless you want to be just a flagrant fauvist and just use wild color everywhere, which usually is pretty scattershot, it's your grays that are going to count for as much as your strong color. See, it's all dry too. When I come back with more pigment, it's just easy as can be. If I haven't gone dark enough on a head where I want it to darken down, it's easy to do. There's that mahogany red. Now, you know, most of you are expecting some kind of real razzle-dazzle with this color, when in fact, if the drawing is sound before you Xerox it, the whole purpose of doing it this way is so that the color can go down really fast and you can hand it off and move on to the next one. So, I'm going to try to get an effect this fast and meets their needs, but doesn't really necessarily require me to spend all day on it just because I feel guilty that it looks finished and it wasn't a lot of time. And there's no rule against mixing paint with this, too. If you want to go back with some accents of acrylic, great. You've got a palette already laid out, or an abbreviated palette of some kind. That's nice. You can do that. Fleshier tone into these too, just so they don't seem too foreign to the heads beneath them. Let's take some black. Get this thing a little moodier. So I have a pretty good base here. Now what I'm going to be able to do in a moment is start pulling out my lights and also drawing in my darks. See how black that wants to go as soon as you put some terpenoid on it?
How come those are going really black, but oh, I guess it did go pretty black in the sky? I'm wondering how it didn't go as black when you added it to the blue in the sky.
This?
Yeah, up there.
Well, partly because it didn't have any tone underneath it. That was Gary's question earlier. Would you put the tone down first before you Xerox it? Because you can put black down so readily with this, why bother? Well, you see that actually by having the tone under these heads, the hair tones that I already sketched in, by doing that, just putting the same amount of black on top of that and rubbing it, it yielded almost pure black. By not having any black under it when I did that, it went 2/3 of the way to black instead of all the way. So if I had some, you know, some streaky black strokes back there, it would saturate that and get really black for me. This color doesn't please me too much. It's not really color, so I'm just going to go back with a little bit of other color and get that in.
Put that mahogany red?
Yeah, I guess that's what it is. Sometimes when you first apply the tissue with the Prisma on it, or with the Terp on it, it wants to pull up color as much as it wants to smear it. So you have to kind of warm it up a little.
So are you able to write off on the axis as a deduction?
Technically. I don't really have massive Kleenex bills. Okay, actually, somebody got a kneaded eraser. I think I've got one. Hold on. Here we go. Okay. Now let's start modeling this thing a little bit. I didn't even bring the photos for these guys, but we can get the effect that I did these from. We can get the effect without really having those. Does someone have a kneaded eraser? This one's a little bit beat.
There's some in there.
Oh, yeah. Thanks, Aaron. Just grab one of those clean ones there. Are there any clean ones? Okay, good. Great. Give me a couple of those. Now, I don't really know how light this is until I start pulling out real lights. So we'll do that. Let's focus that.
Does the eraser take off the Xerox ink as well, or just
nope,
the color?
Just the color.
So, Mark, is this color that you've chosen?
Yes.
Maybe
it's
your choosing or your director's?
No, I just chose. Keep a couple of kneaded erasers around because as the warmth of your hand in using it causes it to get a little bit warm and soft, it becomes more difficult to pull out lights then. Said the other day, if the art director came along and said, Mark, I've got 5 minutes, then I would go into my 1 minute offense and get it done. You know, there's ways of doing it. If you get the effect.
So is that pretty much how you're dealing with it? You're considering the flavor and mood of the film, obviously, for the technique, but also the art director's just giving you time frame, you're saying this is the approach you get based on that?
Yep. We aren't showing anything in this class that's like a Saturday evening post cover. This is all quick turnaround, high profit, high stress work.
Yeah, right on.
That's right.
So you're using an eraser?
Yep. back in there and trying to retouch out the line around the circle of the moon. To me, I see that line around the circle of the moon, it doesn't bother me one bit. Because I got the flavor of it. One thing that helps to relieve some of the stress of some of this work is that it's really fun to do this. So try not to forget that altogether. And definitely practice it at home. I guarantee you'll enjoy it. Gradate this so that it goes darker toward the top. And it's creating a very rich, kind of a transparent color, you see? See how we can gradate that pretty nicely. And that's not so bad. We can even give it, if we chose, a feeling of a little mist or fog. Trees without lightening them at all, since they're Xerox. That makes my job faster. Not only will some of you like some techniques more than another, like this versus markers or versus acrylic, but you'll develop ways of handling this medium that are completely different from the way I'm demonstrating it. You'll borrow and you'll adapt and you'll develop tricks of your own, but not if you don't practice. Don't let it happen that the first time you use this is on the job. Draw well, even then you'll probably be able to pull it off reasonably, but you won't be as pleased with the effect as if you practice it first. It can be combined with markers or acrylics, like I said earlier, too. If I wanted to reinforce the dark limbs of the trees, I could go back with a fine tip marker and do it that way. Or I could do it with a black Prisma. Whatever I think would give it more punch and be faster. Probably a fine tip marker.
Working in this medium would necessitate that you work at a larger size. Like
no, not necessarily. Go ahead.
You wouldn't necessarily do this on a 6x9, would you?
Might, if I was paid to do it.
Well, do you get it clear ahead of time at what size you're going to work and have all that ironed out?
Oh, yes.
Starting?
Yes. Yes. for something, some type or whatever. I'm just setting that up as my premise, so I'm lightening that up. Lights out with the electric eraser. I haven't even started putting in any darks yet. Scratch out and carve out some light planes here, and then I'm going to blend them out with the kneaded eraser so that on a woman's head we keep things rather simple. I do want her to stand off the background a little more than she was doing before I used the electric eraser. See how readily that stuff dries. There's no smearing. Now let's go blend out without losing all of the edge work and definition. Let's kind of soften some of that rough cut effect that we just got.
It's really amazing. amazing.
It's easy to soften it by just blurring the focus. What were you going to say?
It's just amazing how luminous it gets just looking at the screen.
And remember, too, the screen is a little closer to what it's going to look like when it's Xeroxed than is the original. So that's not something that I kind of figured on when I got the TV set up for us, but it actually, since you're always drawing for the Xerox, it's nice to see the translation. Finger, that can sometimes help.
Can this technique get pretty streaky on the Xerox? Maybe if you're not careful with it?
I don't think so. I haven't had any problems with its reproduction. Let's go back and start darkening some areas. Show you some more rendered areas now. Let's go back in and start to reinforce some of our original drawing. This mahogany red's a lot more muted than scarlet red or anything else that you might be inclined to use for some of your transitions around the nose and cheeks. So it works real well with this moonlight scheme because there really aren't any pure scarlets or pinks or anything like that when we have such a cool color influence as this. Render up one head that's in the color influence of the moon, or this semi-moon kind of color influence, which is semi-arbitrary anyway. And then I'll do one of the other heads too that's something closer to a more naturalistic lighting. Let's take the top of his forehead though, where it's more closely influenced by the moonlight, and start working back into it with the Copenhagen blue. Funny thing is that once you've got this mixture down, most people are surprised to even see that you used Prisma on it. They do think it's some kind of a painting. And even though I can see, if I really look, the graininess of the Prisma I'm applying, it tends to meld very nicely into the whole ether of this thing and wind up with something that doesn't look like a drawing on top of a painting, but looks like a seamless whole. W-H-O-L-E. Again, just a seamless whole. The whole thing just working together. And this helps get out some of that Xeroxy drawing quality that it has until such time as you do this. Punch down your darks. grainy on a white sheet of paper, that is to say this black I'm applying, in the midst of all this soup of Prisma and Xeroxing, goes down again as a seamless flat black. That's a yellow moon, so we can get a little bit of yellow into the forehead, maybe. Get a real dark, strong red somewhere. This is Tuscan red, which I like as a good, rich, dark red. Supposing he's got blue eyes. Remember too that color does not matter as much as value. Value has a priority over color, so you can cheat color, you can meld color, you can do a lot of different things with it, especially at this level of presentation.
Since this is intended for reproduction, would you turn in a color copy as opposed to the original? Or would you just turn in the original? You said you turn in your original drawings as well as copies, but does that apply to this as well?
Oh yes, because they have to Xerox from your original drawing for their presentation. Now you should be entitled to get your original back, though, if that is what you want. Which usually, if it's something you like enough to put in your portfolio, you should do. Well, no, yeah, you don't want to hand in just a Xerox. What I do sometimes, I'll hand in as a supplement to the original, I'll hand in a set of Xeroxes so that when they first glance at the original and it's all dog-eared and weird and everything like that, which sometimes happens, they don't judge it on that as a first impression. They see the Xerox of it and they go, ah, that's a relief. So I sometimes send a pack of Xeroxes with my original sketches. But I would never just send Xeroxes.
this. Maybe someone will go out there to the sink and get a cup of water for me so I can just put in a couple of accents with acrylic on this thing. All right, I mean, you know, I can prove my point and render that thing almost to the umpteenth degree and give it a photographic look if I want, but that's not the purpose here. So let's move on to another head. Let's move on to this guy.
What about their expectations? I mean, how far do you take it for their purposes?
They would consider that one of the more finished heads they're going to get this month. You and I might not look at it that way as artists, but if they were with you, they would be pretty happy with that at the level of a rendering. Again, rendering is less important to them than the effect. So we're trained, you know, to get this look and everything like that, and sometimes, you know, it's a lot more than the client really needs.
Could you go back in
it's pretty dark. That's going to, remember, I'm drawing for the Xerox. That's going to Xerox as black gets. So I could do it, but it's really, once I have some spare time, it's kind of a waste of time. You'll notice that this almost gets us back to the white vellum, but not quite. So this is a good example of that right in here. Anyone who's close to it can see that that's not quite going all the way back. Let's just give it a little sort of dappled texture or something here so that it reads flat, but it isn't quite. Another quiet eraser, Mia.
No, I noticed that.
I've never seen that one.
It's more stuff. Just soften it a little bit now. Maybe you want it to glow just a little bit. With me on this Hemery High School is called, but I think we have some darks and stuff in here, so I would just go back and very graphically punch those in.
That's
yep. Remember that since we already have some black in the painting, it's easy to justify putting it into the background and anywhere else. And then after all, it is a night scene, so. Everywhere. I just want to show you how you can draw back into it. If this were something of a finished nature, then we'd want to do more yet. And start transitioning into some other colors if you want to by the time we reach down here. That starts getting us, you know, into details that you can hire a kid on the street to do. So now let's get back into these heads just a little bit. Pop out
couple of little lights here and there. Just to give it a little more sparkle. Sharpen this eraser. Bring it back to a point. And there we have it. Let's do, what's his name's head? What's this guy's name?
Luke Parrott.
Ringo.
Luke Parrott.
Luke Parrott, that's right.
It's like one of the Beatles to me.
Say that again?
Looks like one of the Beatles.
To the Tuscan red now, the turning with the bridge of his nose, and for the turning of the underplane, and for the upper lip, the yellow forehead. By the same token, bring some of the yellow into the middle passage of his head as well. A little bit of bronze yellow. I don't know what we want to do here. There's a million different things we can do. We can put some reflected light, but I don't think that would go with this. We're just going to get into the jaw now. And for that, I'll take some dark brown, pick up just a little sense of the beard. And by that, I just mean, even though he's clean shaven in this photo, on a man's head, there's always just a little bit of a sense of a graying in the area of the jaw. Although, again, it's not a completely different color from the rest of his head. It's just a change in color cast. And I can also see a fall off between the forehead and the lower head as I draw. And it's important to get that. So maybe at most a one value step between the light on his forehead and the light on his jaw. That's if we think in terms of value as a 1 to 10 scale, with 1 or 0 being black and 10 being white. If the value of his head is a 9 or an 8 or a 7.5, then this would be a 7 and this might be a 6.5. So there's a very subtle fall off there. Whatever your darkest darks happen to be, make sure you put them in, because those are going to have a great influence on the values of your lights. This is a nice technique because, you know, you can also use it in life drawing. I know Gregory uses it all the time from the live model. Get some real beautiful effects. The figure up there above the bookcase, second from the end, is an example of Prisma and terpenoid from life. Maybe that's a good way for you to practice before you get a job with this. Now I'm taking the Tuscan red and running it over to Xeroxing next to the Carmen red. Turns from light into shadow, I come in with the Tuscan red. And then here, these planes around the mouth, the mustache, or what would be a mustache if you didn't shave, we have to deal with as being slightly grayer. I said there's going to be a value fall off on the lower head too, so just glazing some pencil over the jaw. Softening the edges of things. Just pull out a couple more light planes. Now the point of this is not, again, to show how intricate and tricky and all that we can be, but how simple and effective we can be. Just like this one, I can carry it farther, but pretty soon it's going to reach a point where any art director at this stage in the drawing, if he has a problem with the artwork at all, it's not going to be because he doesn't think the heads are rendered enough. You may think that, I may think that, but that's not what he's going to be looking for. Now for finish art, this may or may not be, you know, enough. But for purposes of color comps at this stage, it's getting very close to where it wants to be, most to be. Just take a little bit of paint now and show you how you can pop a couple of things on these heads. And for that, you know, you can actually paint with color on this. I think at this point, just to keep it simple, just talk about putting in whites and possibly a couple of darks, although the darks are probably not necessary. Just a little slip of paper or something I can just lay some white, titanium white on, just a tear sheet or a slip sheet from something. It doesn't have to be anything. That's good. Thanks. Thanks a lot. you need to go wider than this. You need to focus that just a bit, maybe, if you can. And you can zoom in a little more if it's possible. As close as you can get us on this head. Let's focus. Now, if you need to go wider than this, it's actually possible if you get Badger pre-reduced airbrush white. It's whiter than titanium white acrylic. And crest lights must be kept relatively small or the thing's going to start looking very chalky. Teeth, I'm pushing it about as far as I can before they start to look too rendered up and too unteeth-like. The teeth should be generally pretty simple.
Tony Robbins.
Huh?
Tony Robbins teeth.
Yeah. Turning of a plane, that's usually where you're going to get a piece of counterpoint or a crest light or an accent. And so it's those places that I'm selecting. And even here, if I were doing a full portrait or a rendering or something like that, I might not pick and choose these in quite the same way. Because here I'm trying to get the effect so that at a distance, in a moment, at a glance, a client will say, well, yeah, that's it. You know, I don't really want to do this in the way that someone like Franz Hals would do it or something.